Hi everyone, this is GKCS. Today we are going to be talking about garbage collection algorithms. We are going to be talking about what are these algorithms in Java specifically, what were the problems that you face in each of these algorithms, and how do you overcome them. So there's been a lot of evolution. The good news here is that it's not specific to Java. A lot of languages like JavaScript, Golang, Python, they have the same community. The developers look at what the other guy is doing and they learn a lot from each other and improve these algorithms. The first problem with garbage collection is to identify what is garbage. So if you see a particular piece of memory, if you have objects in memory, how do you tell that these objects are never ever going to be used again? The way you do that is by identifying those objects which can never be reached from the start of your program. Okay, that makes sense. If you can't reach them, then you can't use them. If you can't use them, they're as good as garbage. The algorithm here is the Tricolor algorithm. You can have a look in the description below. It's a 1969 paper by Knuth. I think he had a book written on this. You have three colors, white, gray, and black. Let's say you have this graph. You start from the root node, which is A in our case. We mark it as gray, which means it is reachable, and also it is being processed right now. So we are using a queue data structure. So this is going to be a breadth first search, traverse all adjacent nodes. And then you mark A as black. Black means it's safe. You're going to keep it in the end. And gray means that there is still more processing to do. So B is at the head of the queue. Pull it out. You get C. B is marked as done. And so on. Till you have F and G. F and G can never be reached. Kick them out. And you have some freed up memory. Similarly, what happens in the real world is you use a stack. So again, you start from the root node and you traverse till F and G are marked as done. Why do you want to use a stack instead of a queue? Well, you can go to a lot of depth and keep few nodes in your stack. While in a queue, you have to actually go level by level. So the number of expected nodes is huge. So this algorithm is perfect. It makes no mistakes. That's a good thing. It will pick up all the garbage and it will not pick up any objects which is not garbage. So your application doesn't have a heart attack or something. But the bad news is that you want to make this as performant as possible. Because when your application is serving requests and in between your garbage collection starts running, it's like your application goes into deep sleep. It doesn't know what's happening. If your garbage collector takes 10 seconds, the request is going to time out, it's going to fail, and your user is going to be unhappy. So if you can reduce the time that the garbage collector is running, it's good for you. There's three ways we can go about this. One is to make this process incremental, meaning you break it into pieces. The second one is to directly attack the problem, say that how do we speed up garbage collection? And the third approach, which is the most complicated, also the one that we'll be applying the most, is concurrency. If you have the operating system and it breaks tasks into time slices, from second 1 to second 10, I'm going to do task A. From 11 to 20, I'm going to do task B, and then again task A, the remaining part of the task, I'll start after 21. But the application which is running has no idea that after 10, it had to pause and then start straight away at 21. Those 10 seconds, what happened in those 10 seconds, it's completely unaware. It's like brain surgery happening. You lose track of time. That's a complicated thing to solve, and that's what we're going to be doing over here. And so our first approach is trying to reduce the amount of time that a garbage collector runs through the generational hypothesis. This is 1984, one of the papers in the description. It mentions that when you see the average lifetime of an object, which is in memory, if an object survives a particular period of time, it's expected to survive for longer. Old objects tend to stay around and new objects tend to die quickly. You can think of this as high infant mortality rate. If a person lives up to the age of 10, you're expecting them to live to 70. Otherwise, you're expecting 30% of the people to die. That's how you can look at objects in memory also. What this tells us is that looking at the state of an object, looking at the age of an object, if it is less than a particular threshold, monitor it more frequently because it's likely that it's going to die. So you're going to get more memory freed up from those objects. While the older ones, you should monitor less frequently because the chance of them living is pretty high. With this idea, we come up with our first garbage collector, which is take your memory and break it into two pieces. Okay, partition it into an old region and a young region. The young region has all young objects. Over here, you do a lot of the monitoring. While the old region, the chances of them dying is low, so the polling for objects is going to be less frequent. The young generation is also broken into further regions. One is the Eden region. These guys are new babies, newborn babies. It's from the Bible, Eden. And then you have two survivor regions. We'll just talk about why the survivor regions are so important. Imagine you have the Eden region. You get these new objects being allocated over here, six of them. And the garbage collector runs. It goes through the Eden region, says that, okay, 2, 3, 4, and 6 are dead. They no longer have pointers to them. So 1 and 5 are survivors. So you push them onto the survivor region. Let's say survivor region 1. Then you get 6 more objects allocated. A lot of them die. And 11 has to be pushed to the survivor region. But the thing over here is there's something called compaction. You take all the objects and you stick them together so that whenever you need free space, you have entire blocks of memory free. Compaction requires you to copy objects from one place to another or basically move them. If you have 2 survivor spaces, you can directly make copies of the objects 1 and 5 and you don't need to fit in 11 in the right place. It's just going to go like boom, boom, boom. So if there was an object in between 1 and 5, let's say object 2, and it had died in the survivor region, then you would need to compact in a weird way. Over here, there's a direct copy. You're seeing that the color of these objects is getting more and more green. What I'm showing is that the age of these objects is incrementing. After a particular threshold, object 5 and 1 are going to be promoted to the old region. Once they're in the old region, you're going to be pulling them less frequently for garbage collection because they tend to live longer. But there's a problem. The problem is that what if you have objects in the old region pointing to the young guys? So you have parents in one room and you have children in one room. Whichever infant has a parent pointing to them, you can't go and kill that child or you can't collect it as garbage. It's pretty cynical, but yeah. Let's say you have 1 and 4, which are survivors of the first 6 objects that you have. The problem is you have old objects also. And the old object 2 is pointing to 3 and 5. So those objects are not dead. They're still being used. So you have to again make them alive. But this is completely against the idea of generational hypothesis. I mean, I did not want to check the old generation frequently because the chance of them dying is low. Now, because of the old pointers pointing to the young guys, I have to go through all the old region objects also and figure out where they're pointing in case they have young objects being pointed to. Over here, we use a very important concept. This is going to come up all over the Java garbage collection algorithms called code injection. If you compile a .java file, then you get a .class file. And we say that .class runs on any hardware. It just depends on the interpreter. The machine has to be able to read a .class file. That's its responsibility. As a programmer, you can send a .class file. There is something called just-in-time in Java. It sees the places where the old generation is going to be making a pointer to the young generation. Whenever you're doing a write operation, which is x is equal to young.a, it updates something called a card table. So you can think of this as a Bloom filter. Basically, you have a bunch of bits which are saying that which parts of the old region are dirty. So whenever you're making an old object point to a young object, it's saying that this part of the old region is dirty. Partition number 3 in the old region, which has objects 2 and 5, check their pointers. If there are any young objects over there, mark them as alive. This is faster than obviously scanning all the objects, and the total number of old objects pointing to the young guys is low. So now we have directly optimized the garbage collection process because we are no longer querying the entire memory. But like we said, this depends on the generational hypothesis, which may or may not be true. It is generally true, but there are certain cases where it doesn't work. And the prime example for this is caching. The thing about caches is that A, they have an expiry time. Most caches have an expiry time because you want to get rid of stale data, especially in a distributed system. And B, objects which are least recently used are usually kicked out the fastest. So it isn't whether the object is alive or not, it's whether it's in use or not. And the longer the object stays, the higher chance it has of getting kicked out. So caches are very interesting. They don't actually go by the generational hypothesis. There's also another example. Let's take a queue. You have 6 objects over here. You have the front pointer pointing to 1. And after a certain period of time, you have a promotion of 1, 2, and 3 going to the old generation. Now let's say the front of the queue goes from 1 to 5. So all the objects 1, 2, 3, and 4 are technically dead because there's no incoming pointer to them. The GC is going to run on the old generation less frequently, so they're going to stick around. and they're not marked as dead yet. They're not collected yet. 3 is pointing to 4 from the old generation, and the garbage collector doesn't dare pick it up because it's just a dirty bloom filter tick that 3 has. So that object which is dead in the young generation is still staying over there.
What's eventually going to happen is that the old objects will keep the young dead objects alive. This is called nepotism in garbage collection. Basically, some objects get promoted without being deserving to get promoted. There are projects like Kafka which get around this. They have some interesting paging mechanisms. But some of the garbage collection algorithms that we'll be looking into, especially Shenandoah, get around this by getting rid of the generational hypothesis. So guys, I know that this was a very technical video. It's actually made for senior engineers. I spoke about this on JCon. I recently spoke about this in Credit Suisse with their engineering team. If you have any doubts on this, feel free to put them in the comments. I'll answer all of them. I still check all of my comments. Yeah, you might have 300,000 subscribers, but that attitude of mine has, I don't think is going to change much. Of course, if you're looking for more engineering and system design content, I have a website, interviewready.io, which talks about concurrency and all these things. Stuff that engineers use every day. And you can also subscribe to the channel if you're looking for videos like this. Until next time then, see you.